Welcome to worship this morning with Crescent Hill Baptist Church. We are glad that you have decided to join us today. We are grateful for musical leadership this morning from Laura Lee Duckworth and Allison Hammonds. May the peace of Christ be with you. Let us begin with prayer. God who sows good things, we gather together this morning hoping that it is not quite time for the harvest yet. We feel we have more growing to do. Lately, we have felt like the whole field has been tossed into the furnace, and we must have been tares all along. Remind us in this hour of worship that we are indeed children of the kingdom, and that someday we will shine in the sun before you, gathered in at last. May this time of prayer and word and song strengthen and nurture us as we grow toward righteousness. May our ears be open and our hearts be always seeking you. It is in the name of Jesus the Christ, our teacher and redeemer, we pray. Amen.
Our gospel lesson this morning comes from Matthew chapter 13, verses 24 through 30 and 36 through 43. He put before them another parable. The kingdom of heaven may be compared to someone who sowed good seeds in his field. But while everybody was asleep, an enemy came and sowed weeds among the wheat and then went away. So when the plants came up and bore grain, then the weeds appeared as well. And the slaves of the householder came and said to him, "Master, did you not sow good seed in your field? Where then did these weeds come from?" He answered, "An enemy has done this." The slave said to him, "Then do you want us to go and gather them?" But he replied, "No, for in gathering the weeds, you would uproot the wheat along with them. Let both of them grow together until the harvest. And at harvest time, I will tell the reapers, 'Collect the weeds first and bind them in bundles to be burned, but gather the wheat into my barn.'" Then he left the crowds and went into the house. And his disciples approached him, saying, "Explain to us the parable of the weeds of the field." He answered, "The one who sows the good seed is the Son of Man. The field is the world, and the good seed are the children of the kingdom. The weeds are the children of the evil one. And the enemy who sowed them is the devil. The harvest is the end of the age, and the reapers are angels. Just as the weeds are collected and burned up with fire, so will it be at the time of the age. The Son of Man will send his angels, and they will collect out his kingdom all causes of sin and all evildoers. And they will throw them into the furnace of fire, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Then the righteous will shine like the sun in the kingdom of their Father. Let anyone with ears listen." The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. It is now time for the children's moment. Good morning, boys and girls. I want you to help me identify some things I have here. Can you do that? First, we're going to guess if it is a weed or a flower. Let's look at these pictures. Here's the first picture. Do you think this is a weed or a flower? If you guessed flower, you are correct. This is called a blue salvia. Now let's look at this next photo. Do you think this one is a weed or a flower? If you guessed flower, you're wrong. This is a weed. It's a dandelion. You've probably seen these in your yard. And even though they have a little yellow flower, we don't want them in our yards. So you probably have seen your parents pull them out. Okay, let's try a different set. This time we're gonna guess if the tree is poisonous or if it's safe. Let's look at this first photo of a tree. If you ate something from this tree, would it be safe? You probably guessed this one correct. It's an apple tree. It is safe. We can eat the apples. Now let's look at the second tree. Do you think this tree is safe or poisonous? If you guessed poisonous, you're actually correct. This tree is a coral tree. And if you were to eat its seeds, you would get very sick. Even though it's a very pretty tree with nice red flowers, it can be very dangerous. It's a little tricky to tell them apart in some cases, isn't it? Both our flower and our weed had flowers, and both of the trees were nice, pretty trees. But sometimes it's difficult to discern the appearance of which things are good and safe and which ones are not. We can't always tell just by looking. And if we don't have the right understanding or knowledge about things, we won't know. In today's parable, Jesus talked about how some weeds got mixed in among the good seeds. A farmer was planting, but an enemy came and threw in some weeds so that when they would get mixed up with the wheat. The workers wanted to go and pluck out all the leaves, but the farmer told them to wait and let the farmer decide which ones were good and which ones needed to be pulled out when it was time to harvest. What do you think that story means for us? I think sometimes we try to decide who is good or who isn't based on what a person looks like or how that person is dressed. Like trying to tell the difference between a weed and a flower, or a poisonous tree and a safe tree, it would be easy to get confused. I think Jesus is trying to teach us that it's not our job to try to decide who are the good people and who aren't. God knows what is happening in our hearts and in other people's hearts. Our job is not to judge people. Our job is to show the love of Jesus to everyone. So let's thank God. Dear God, help us not to judge each other. Help us to show your love to those we meet. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Not too long before the Boston Marathon bombing occurred in April of 2013, I created a Twitter account. I had heard that Twitter provided more direct access to the latest news and developments than any other social media platform. My annual tradition as a runner is to watch the Boston Marathon every Monday in April when it is annually televised. And 2013 was no different. I had quit watching the race because the primary competitors had crossed the finish line well before the bombs exploded along Boylston Street. But I still had the marathon coverage on in the background when the bombs exploded. I immediately turned on CNN and followed their coverage of the situation for the remainder of the day. I relied on cable news networks' coverage for the latest information regarding the situation for a couple of days. However, as the week went on, I began checking that new social media platform I had joined, Twitter, to see what people there had to say about the situation. That week, I discovered the power of Twitter. It did not take me long, a click here, a click there, a click here, to stumble upon the Twitter account of the younger brother who was on the run from the police and the FBI. Many of his friends were tweeting to his account pleas for him to turn himself into authorities. Some of his friends were telling him that they knew where he was hiding and were threatening to relay that information on to other authorities if he did not take matters into his own hands. The cable news networks, by contrast, which of course must operate within a much higher degree of integrity, were not providing anywhere near the kind of information that appeared to be legitimately available, that I could access, that you could access, that anyone could access by way of a few swipes and taps on my phone via Twitter. That week, I discovered the power of Twitter. So I was not surprised then when what unfolded in 2016 unfolded in the manner and fashion in which it did in that election year. By that time, many smart people understood the power of social media, Twitter, as well as Facebook, Instagram, other platforms. Many people, smart people, and many rich people knew that such platforms could be used to circumnavigate traditional conduits of information, like television or radio, in order to pepper people on both sides of the political spectrum with incendiary and often misleading memes, pictures, videos, and other statements. These people understood that what shows up in a Facebook feed or a Twitter timeline is largely driven by certain algorithms, and they knew that flooding the platforms with certain material would spread throughout the social media ecosystem like a wildfire. And guess what? They were successful. Many nefarious actors, both domestically based as well as foreign based, knew that they could use social media to either advance the chances of their preferred candidate winning the presidential election of 2016, or they could use social media to polarize an already contentious and divided United States citizenry. I discovered the power of social media in 2013, but I discovered the destructive power of social media in 2016. And now the beat goes on. At no other time in my lifetime has our nation been more divided and polarized. Social media is not solely at fault for our division. In fact, I would contend that social media is more of a catalyst than a foundational element in this chain reaction that we are dealing with. Racism, poverty, greed, pride, and even ignorance are some of the issues at the root of our problem. But social media has proven to be a spark that ignites the powder keg that has created and will continue to create an explosion that leads to fragmentation and polarization. Believe it or not, all this brings us to our scripture passage today. Today we ponder a parable spoken by Jesus that is a continuation of a theme of parables, including the one we contemplated last week, from the 13th chapter of Matthew's Gospel regarding seeds and their growth. In this parable, a farmer sowed good seed in his field, but an enemy came along and infested the field full of good seed with weeds. Rather than gather up the weeds, which would do harm to the good seeds and the wheat, the farmer informed the slaves who worked in the fields to let the good and the bad, the wheat and the weeds, grow together. Yanking up the weeds would destroy the crop. Come harvest time, the wheat and weeds would be separated, but it would have been an act of extreme stupidity to do that while they were growing together. The wheat and the weeds, the good and the bad, had no choice but to coexist until the season was said and done. So it is with us in these days and in these times and in this place. Like you, I imagine, I have grown somewhat weary of what has now become the cliche, we are all in this together. Nonetheless, it is true. Like the wheat and weeds, the good and the bad, we must, or at least during certain seasons, coexist with one another. This does not mean that we should just close our mouths and quit speaking up and quit speaking out the truth in love in order to rectify those wrongs and injustices that have created, that are the underlying causes of the polarization that we are experiencing in our country right now. Right is right and wrong is wrong. And we need to be willing to speak up and articulate what is truthful in a loving manner. However, it does mean that we must do this together. It is true that we are all in this together. The wheat and the weeds, the good and the bad, all of us is a field that is populated by both wheat and weeds, good and bad. And guess what? So is our community. And so is our state, so is our nation, so is our world. Will Campbell died a few years back, and an author described Campbell in a memorial piece published in the Oxford American as an iconoclastic Baptist minister from Amity County, Mississippi, an accomplished author and activist for the socially condemned. Beyond that, he was a whiskey-sipping, guitar-toting, inspirational and profane bootleg preacher who kicked it with country musicians, civil rights leaders, and Klansmen. In his twilight years, he also taught from time to time at Vanderbilt, and I was fortunate enough to take a couple of courses in which he lectured while I was there. Campbell was only one of a few white Southern Baptist preachers in the 1950s and 60s who outspokenly stood up for civil rights for blacks during the middle of the last century. So folks were confused when Campbell decided to befriend members of the KKK. Campbell reports that he lost many friends that he had made during his years fighting for civil rights for blacks. In the author's reflections on Campbell's life soon after Campbell's death, Bill Leonard, who many at Crescent Hill know, a former Crescent Hill member, wrote, in his book, Brother to a Dragonfly, Will recalled that he preached his first sermon from a pulpit Bible donated to his Mississippi Baptist church by the KKK, and recounted a 1960s exchange with a Klansman who asserted that the organization, quote, stands for peace, harmony, and freedom. In that exchange, Will asked the Klansman, What means are you willing to use to accomplish those glorious ends? The Klansman replied, "The means we are willing to use are as follows: murder, torture, threats, blackmail, intimidation, burning, guerrilla warfare, whatever it takes." Will noted. And then he stopped, and the Klansman stopped, and I knew that I had set a little trap for him and had cleverly let him snap the trigger, but then he started again. "Now, preacher, let me ask you a question. You tell me what we stand for in Vietnam." Suddenly, I knew a lot of things I had not known before, Campbell recalled. I knew that I had been caught in my own trap. Suddenly, I knew that we were a nation of Klansmen. I knew that as a nation, we stood for peace and harmony and freedom in that war that defined the words, and that that means we were employing to accomplish those ends were identical with the ones that he had listed that he would employ to meet his ends. At that point, Campbell realized that although he vehemently disagreed with that Klansman on many fronts, he also knew that it was very important for him to maintain relationship with such individuals, and he recognized that he wasn't much better than anybody else anyway. "I am wheat and weeds. You are wheat and weeds. This world is full of good and bad. We are all in this together. So let us not grow weary of speaking Jesus-inspired words of truth and love so that injustices come to their end." But this parable reminds us that we must also realize that each person is a beloved child in the eyes of God, even our enemies. My father used to tell me before every competition I participated in as a childhood, athletic, academic, otherwise, he would tell me this: "Do your best, leave the rest, and let God keep the box score. Do your best, leave the rest, and let God keep the box score." I believe those few words sum up this parable, an important parable for these days and these times in a nutshell. Advocate for justice. Do your best to love others. Do your best to show compassion and kindness. Do your best to rectify systems that are not right, but do not throw anyone away in the process. And let God keep the box score. Amen.
Please join me in prayer. God, as we sit in quietness, our thoughts are far from quiet. We are wrestling with doubts and fears. We are looking for answers. We are hoping against hope. We are seeking strength. We are hungry. We are hungry for warm sunshine, for healed bodies, for rest from tears. Your word says the hungry will be filled, and we ask today for you to fill us. Fill us with the breath of life. Fill us with thankful hearts. Fill us with calmness, courage, and most of all, with the knowledge of your presence. There are those we know and love who are ill, and we ask, God, that you would surround them with your strong and healing presence. Grant wisdom to those who need answers to difficult questions. Grant hope to those who despair and friendship to those who are lonely. Most of all, God, may we know your love, your great love you have for each one. You know the hairs on our heads. You count each beat of our heart. You knit us together when we were being formed. You know our getting up and our lying down. You are familiar with all of our ways. There is no place we can hide from you. You were there at our beginning, and you will be with us through to the end. May we not lose sight of your constant care. We look to you, O God of the present, in our communities and in our world. Continue to show us how we at Crescent Hill Baptist Church can be part of your work in this world. Teach us how we can grow into faith and become more and more like Christ. We also ask, Lord, that you would bless the work of our hands. Bless all that we offer today, not only what we give of our money, but of the offerings of our time and talents. And now we gather all of our prayers together, the spoken and the unspoken, and pray the prayer that you taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us of our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Christ beside me, Christ before me, Christ behind me, King of my heart, Christ within me, Christ below me, Christ above me, never to part. Christ on my right hand, Christ on my left hand, Christ all around me, shield in the strife, Christ in my sleeping, Christ in my sitting, Christ in my rising, light of my life. Christ be in all hearts, thinking about me. Christ be on all tongues, telling of me. Christ be the vision in eyes that see me, in ears that hear me, Christ ever be. Christ beside me, Christ before me, Christ behind me, King of my heart, Christ within me, Christ below me, Christ above me, never to
Thank you for joining us this morning. A few reminders before we go. We are preparing for an in-person gathering on Sunday, July 26th at 9 a.m. There will be more information available in the church newsletter about the requirements for this gathering. We also are excited that this Wednesday, Bill Thomason will continue our study on Ezekiel during our Wednesday night time together. Our Wednesday night meals also continue. Please sign up by Monday at noon if you would like a meal this week. We also invite you to participate in an upcoming book discussion on the book The Cross and the Lynching Tree by James Cone. If you would like to participate, that begins Sunday, August 9th at 5 p.m. Go ahead and obtain a copy of the book if you would like to participate. You can sign up by emailing me, Brittany, at chbcky.org. We also encourage you to continue giving. You can give online through the church website, you can give by text, or you can mail a check to the church office. Hear now these words of blessing and benediction. As you go, remember, this is not the end, but only the beginning. This is not goodbye, just a temporary separation. For in God we are all one family, one people, bound together by the unconditional love of God forever. And in spite of any evidence to the contrary, good is stronger than evil. Love is stronger than death. And Jesus Christ is Lord of all. Amen and amen.